Hi and welcome to this revision video. We'll be looking at how to generate electricity, how electricity can be moved around the country using the national grid, and also we'll be looking at efficiency. So let's start off by looking at the dynamo effect. So on the diagram that we have here, okay, we can see a variety of pieces of equipment which you should be familiar with from perhaps experiments in the lab. So we have the ammeter, okay, or sometimes we use a galvanometer because it's a little bit more sensitive. We've got a wire, okay, we have two magnets, one with the north, one with the south pole, okay, and all we're going to do is we're going to move the wire through the magnetic field. So as the wire passes through the magnetic field on the ammeter, you would see it move across in a direction. So we can see here, okay, the movement of the wire is upwards and it moves across to the negative side. Now that proves, in this case, okay, that we have an electrical current being produced. But what we need to know is how that's being produced. So for this, we need to think about the structure of a wire itself. And we should be aware, okay, that wires have electrons within them. So as the wire moves through this magnetic field, the electrons are all pushed in one direction. We call that pushing force a voltage, which I'm sure you've heard of before. So the voltage causes the electrons to move in one direction. And the movement of electrons is what we refer to as electricity. Now we did say before that as the wire moves upwards, the needle on the ammeter would move across to this negative side. But when the wire leaves the magnetic field, it would go back to zero, because there is no current being produced. So to produce a current, the wire has to cut through the magnetic field. So how this normally works is we move the wire backwards and forwards through the magnetic field. And as it goes up and down, the needle on the ammeter will move left and right, from negative to positive, which is what we call alternating current. So here we have two voltage time graphs. So we can see one represents a DC source, which stands for direct current, and the other one represents an AC source, or alternating current. Now the first thing that should stand out for you is that the DC source has a straight line. Now that can either be at the top or at the bottom, and all that means, okay, is that the current is moving in one direction, or the voltage, in this case, is acting in one direction. With the AC source, we can see it get a very much a wave-like pattern. Now all that means is that in this top part, the voltage is going one direction and heads back to the zero, and then it goes in the opposite direction, which is why we call it alternating, because it keeps swapping directions. So how does this link to the dynamo effect that we showed literally just a minute ago? Well, this first section here would represent as the wire moves in an upwards direction through the magnetic field. So we get a voltage induced that pushes the electrons and causes an electrical current. We then have to move the wire in the opposite direction, backwards or downwards through the magnetic field, which gives it the current in the opposite direction, or in this case the voltage in the opposite direction. And that means that it's going to be going one way, then a second way, and therefore it's alternating current. The dynamo effect, or electromagnetic induction as it's sometimes called, is exactly what we can use right now to be able to see this video. And how the electricity that is being used to power your computer or mobile phone or whatever it is you're viewing this on is produced is through a generator. So what we have here is a diagram of exactly that. This is what we call the AC generator. So the first thing we notice is we still have our two magnets here. Okay, but instead of someone moving a wire up and down through these magnetic fields, instead what we have is a coil of wire. Now a coil of wire is just lots and lots of loops of wire wrapped around a metal frame. And by increasing the number of coils of wire, it means we can increase the voltage induced and increase the amount of current produced also. So how does this work? Well, actually it's quite a simple idea. We have our coil of wire, and what we're going to do is we're going to spin it in this direction. So you can see already the magnetic lines of flux, or the magnetic field, is going in this direction. It's going the opposite direction here. So if I spin the coil of wire against it, then what's going to happen, okay, is that the coils of wire cut through the magnetic field. And they cut through it quite quickly. Now the more of the wire that cuts through the magnetic field, the greater the voltage induced and the greater the current that we can get out of this particular generator using slip rings and carbon brushes. Now, for the exam, one of the things you need to be able to do is explain how we can maximise the amount of electricity produced in an AC generator. So for this, we just need to think things through logically. We have two magnets. So by increasing the strength of those magnets, it will increase the magnetic field, and therefore we should be able to induce more voltage and draw out more electricity. That's one way. Second way of doing it would be to add more coils of wire. The more wire there is, the more wire can cut through the magnetic field, and once again, more voltage can be induced. The final way, and the way that certainly you may have used on a bicycle, okay, when you ride at night, okay, and the lights come on using a dynamo, is to spin this faster. So the faster this is spun, the quicker it will cut through the magnetic lines of flux or the magnetic field, and once again, more voltage is induced, and you're going to be able to take out far more electricity. Now that you understand what the dynamo effect is and how a generator works, we can apply it to a situation such as a power station. Now, a power station works through a very simple idea. Okay, all we're going to want to do is turn a generator. Now, rather than having someone there pedaling a bike or spinning a coil of wire inside a magnetic field, we decide to use coal. So by burning coal, we're going to produce a large amount of heat. Okay, we pump water through a boiler. Now, obviously, when you heat water, it turns into steam. And the steam is put through small pipes to generate high pressure. And that high pressure is very, very important, because that then means that the steam moves faster. That fast-moving steam then is used to turn a turbine. And a turbine is just a series of different fans all connected, okay, to make a shaft, okay, or a pole, okay, rotate as quickly as possible. That rotating pole or shaft, okay, is fed into a generator, and on it, okay, will either be a magnet or, more likely, okay, a large coil of wire. And just as we saw previously, as that coil of wire rotates within a magnetic field, or as the magnet rotates inside a coil of wire, we get a voltage induced. That means electrons are pushed, okay, and if electrons are moving, we have alternating current, and therefore electricity. Now that our electricity has been generated, we need to get it to the home. So from the power station, we use a step-up transformer. Step-up just means that we're going to increase the voltage. Okay? So by increasing the voltage here to 400 kilovolts, which is 400,000 volts, we actually make it more efficient. Okay? And it makes it easier to be able to get to our homes. It's then sent down thick electrical wires which are attached to pylons. Sometimes you might see those down the side of the motorway. Once it becomes closer towards a city or town, okay, it might be put through a substation. Okay, and in that substation, there is a step-down transformer. So rather than increasing the voltage this time, we reduce the voltage. Okay, now that the voltage has been reduced, okay, we can then send it off, okay, to various other sections around the country. Okay, so it could go to a factory. Now, factories are probably going to need more electricity, okay, than necessarily your home. So therefore, when it comes to a domestic area, such as your street, okay, or your estate, or wherever you live, you'll find also another localized substation. And that reduces the voltage once more, but this time to 230 volts. And 230 volts is exactly what's coming out of your plug now, okay, to power your computer in order to watch this video. The final part of this video is going to concentrate on efficiency. Now, if we say something's efficient, well, that means it's very, very good at doing its job. So a light bulb that's efficient is very, very good at giving us light. I don't think any of us really want our light bulbs to give us much heat. Okay, that's not really its purpose, although they do. So this diagram here is what's called a Sankey diagram. Okay, and it shows us three things. It shows us, first of all, the energy which comes in, or as we refer to it now, the input energy. It shows us the useful energy which comes out. So in the example of the light bulb, this would be light. Okay, and it also shows us the energy that's wasted. In this case, that would be heat. Now, if we had a light bulb that was giving off this much heat compared to this much light, we'd probably have an issue. Okay, but for the sake of arguments, okay, we'll just use this as an example. So to use this idea on this page here, all we're going to do is we're going to take into account two of the three things. So we're going to look at the energy input and the useful energy output. And we're going to be looking at them as a proportion of each other. So realistically, if I take this section here, what we're looking at is how much of this is a proportion of the total input energy as a percentage. And that will also then tell us how efficient something is at doing its job. As always in physics, there's mathematics, okay, and there's a formula that we can use to calculate efficiency. So previously, we had the useful energy output, and we had the total energy input. So just like in a test, okay, if you had 100 marks available to you, that would be your total available marks. If you were only getting, let's say, 30 out of the available 100, then that would be your score. So there isn't really any difference here between the calculation for efficiency and calculating a percentage score. For any higher tier paper, you may be required to rearrange the formula, which is why underneath here, okay, I put together a nice formula triangle that may help you to solve these issues. There is another video on rearranging scientific formulas if you're not sure about how to do this yourself. So, I've abbreviated some of the terms in here. So efficiency is still down here, so EFF for efficiency. EO is energy output. EI is energy input. Now, using this formula triangle, we can use a formula triangle to work out any of the different permutations that they could be asked in the exam. So, for example, if I were to work out what the total energy input is, I know that would be the energy output divided by the efficiency, which is always going to be in a percentage. If I want to know what the energy output is, then it would be the efficiency times energy input. So now what we're going to do is we're going to go through a worked example to show you how this can be put into action. With any physics-style exam question that involves maths, it's a good idea to go through the question and pull out the most important piece of information. So we've got a light bulb that's 75% efficient and has a total input of 60 joules of energy. So therefore, okay, the first part there is this 75% efficiency. That's very important for us. And the second most important part for us is this total input energy of 60 joules. So the question is asking us, well, what is the useful output? So there are steps that we can put in place to work this out. First thing to do is use a formula triangle. Now we're trying to calculate the useful output, or the useful energy output. So that's this top part here, EO. So if we were to cover that with our hands, that would only leave us with the bottom section, which means that the formula for energy output is efficiency times energy input. So the first step I would recommend is writing down that exact formula. So first thing we have here is the useful output equals efficiency times energy input. Now once we know the formula, we can start to input some numbers. So we know that the useful output in this case, okay, is 60 joules. And we know the efficiency, okay, is 75%. So to turn that into a decimal, we divide by 100. 75 divided by 100 would give us 0.75. So 60 times 0.75, okay, will be what our useful output actually is. So if you multiply 60 by 0.75, that actually gives us 45. Now the last thing we need to think about is what the units are for this particular equation. So it says, what is the useful output? It's referring to energy, and you should know, okay, that energy is always measured in joules. So therefore the answer would be that it is 45 joules of useful output. So that's all of the topic of generating electricity covered. Hopefully it's been of some use. If so, feel free to let me know. And good luck revising.